Welcome to the Siemens EDA podcast series on 3D IC chiplet ecosystems, brought to you by the Siemens Thought Leadership Team. I'm your host, John McMillan. In our first podcast on 3D IC heterogeneous integration, we talked about the disaggregation of once monolithic implementation architectures into several smaller functional chips or chiplets, which are then re-aggregated or integrated using a high-performance package. If you missed that episode, we encourage you to check it out in the Siemens podcast community blogs. Today, in our second podcast of the 3D IC series, we will discuss the current state of chiplet-based designs, the future direction, and what is required to facilitate a chiplet ecosystem. I'm pleased to be joined again by my special guest, Tony Mastroianni, who is the Director of Advanced Packaging Solutions at Siemens Digital EDA. Welcome, Tony. And thank you for taking the time to talk with me again today about chiplet ecosystems. And before we dive into the discussion, would you mind giving our listeners just a brief recap of your current role and background?
Sure, John. Currently, I'm responsible for driving the advanced packaging design flows and methodologies at Siemens EDA. My background historically has been in IC design and project management. More recently, prior to Siemens, I was involved in actually developing advanced package design flows for a fabless semiconductor company.
Great. Thanks, Tony. Before we look ahead, let's take a look back and discuss the current state of heterogeneous integration. Can you please tell us what types of applications and packaging technologies are currently deploying 3D IC methodologies?
Really, when we talk about 3D IC, there's generally, it's kind of a catch-all phrase, but it really includes 2.5D and 3D. So 2.5D applications involves putting a chip or a chiplet on top of a silicon interposer, and those devices are interconnected on that interposer. So it's really a two-dimensional integration of chip or chiplets inside the package, forming a system. 3D kind of falls into two different classes. And today, really, the predominant type of 3D is what we call stacked die. That's where you put one chip on top of another die. So those are the general types of designs and technologies that are used in packaging. Applications that deploy 2.5D integration today are predominantly high-performance compute or HPC devices, such as CPUs, GPUs, and network processors, as well as artificial intelligence and machine learning devices, all of which leverage high bandwidth HBM memories. Another class of devices use 2.5D integration to decompose a very large design, too large to implement as a single monolithic die, into smaller blocks of functionality. These blocks are implemented as discrete chiplet components, which are integrated into a single package. This Lego block approach has the benefits of deploying much larger, more complex designs. This approach, referred to as die disaggregation, offers the added benefit of lower cost, since the yield of the smaller chiplet blocks is considerably larger than a very large die, resulting in a reduction in the composite sum of the silicon cost of the device. An additional benefit of this approach is to implement various product configurations, such as multi-core devices, using packaging technologies instead of doing full custom additional ASIC designs. This results in a significant reduction in the design time and cost in developing additional product variants. Companies such as Intel and AMD are deploying this technique for their latest generation of processors. Now, currently, 3D applications are predominantly stacking either memory chips or sensors on top of another chip. So again, these are typically very customized type of applications as opposed to general purpose chiplets. Just making the connection vertically by stacking the die allows three-dimensional type implementation of the chip. And that can be combined with 2D. So you can actually stack die on top of each other and also combine them with other either 3D or single chiplets on an interposer. So disaggregated die and 3D type of designs, they're kind of more specialized, and they're currently being implemented by a relatively small number of companies that have very advanced IC design capabilities.
It's interesting. So today, since only a small number of sophisticated users are doing these types of designs. Where do you see the industry heading to expand the adoption of 3D IC into a broader set of applications and user base?
For the foreseeable future, I think 3D applications will continue to be dominated by these advanced users doing complex processors or sensor-based type applications. The explosive growth that we're predicting with heterogeneous integration is really likely to be dominated by applications deploying general-purpose chiplet devices that are integrated onto a 2.5D interposer.
So, Tony, what types of chiplets are available today, and what type of new chiplets do you anticipate coming to market?
So today, I would say arguably HBM memories really are the only general-purpose chiplets that are in the market today. And they're used in the applications such as, you know, I talked about earlier, high-performance compute and AI type of applications. Now, I did talk about die disaggregation of these complex processor type of applications. And that's basically splitting a very customized chip into many pieces. IP disaggregation would actually be similar approach, but rather than breaking a custom chip into separate pieces, you would actually replace special purpose IP that would normally be implemented inside the chip or system on chip, as it's referred to, SoC. And you would actually replace that with a special purpose IP chiplet. And rather than integrating that IP inside the ASIC, you would integrate that IP in your system in the package on an interposer. So this is what we would call IP disaggregation. And these IP chiplets can include functions such as high-speed, long-reach SerDes, high-performance analog, RF, or specialized processors. Really, it's a broad set of general-purpose reusable chiplets that would be sold out in the marketplace, and they could be used as building blocks in a system and package as opposed to IP that is sold as general-purpose IP building blocks to be integrated into a chip.
So I suspect these general-purpose chiplets will be offered by a host of vendors implemented in an ASIC process best suited for their IP. But what is required to drive the adoption of this broader set of general-purpose chiplet devices?
John, that is a very good point. These chiplets can leverage specific technology and process nodes to optimize chiplet devices for their respective functionality, cost, and performance. The global HBM market was over $1 billion in 2020 and is growing at a rate of over 25% per year. The general purpose chiplet model can follow a similar path. I believe the explosive market forecast for chiplet devices will likely motivate prospective chiplet vendors into entering this new market. This market will, however, require some level of standardization of the models delivered with the chiplet die in order to be generally adopted by system integrators. EDA workflows will also be required to facilitate the design and verification of chiplet-based devices. Additionally, the adoption of standardized assembly rules will also be critical to the success of this market. The Chiplet Design Exchange, or CDX, is an open working group formed under the ODSA OCP subproject. The charter of this group is to standardize chiplet models and define workflows to facilitate a chiplet ecosystem. CDX recently published a white paper proposing a set of standardized chiplet models. I presented this paper at the IEEE 3D IC conference last November at North Carolina State University. This year, CDX will continue working on heterogeneous package design and verification workflows, as well as supporting an effort to establish a common set of 2.5D assembly rules. The next step will be for the general adoption or refinement of these models by prospective chiplet vendors. Following that, we'll need the EDA workflows that can generate and consume these models and support the design and verification of chiplet-based designs. And then, eventually, we will need the system integrators to adopt these tools and workflows.
So standardizing on a common set of chiplets deliverables seems like a good start towards establishing an ecosystem. What kind of models is the CDX group recommending, and where can someone learn more about the models?
John, the CDX group includes a broad set of contributors from several companies, including EDA vendors, OEM, fabless semiconductor designers, OSATs, silicon IP providers, and potential chiplet providers. This diverse team put a lot of thought into this and defined a comprehensive list comprised of 10 different categories, including over 30 different models and deliverables that we are requesting chiplet providers to deliver with their chiplet devices. One of our key tenets was to strongly recommend machine-readable models that can be consumed by EDA tools and workflows. There is, however, still a need to include some level of documentation and user guidelines. Some of these models are optionals, and others may not be applicable for some chiplet devices. These categories include behavioral, physical, power, timing, electrical, and production test models and deliverables, as well as models required to signal and power integrity analysis. The need to ensure the source and integrity of these chiplet components will likely become a critical requirement in the foreseeable future. Although this was not an area of focus in the CDX group, optional security agents were included in the list for sake of completeness. There is another OCP group working on security, as well as several other efforts in the industry. In addition to these recommended models, new business models, including licensing, pricing, distribution, and support models, will need to be established by the industry to accommodate the needs of this new market. So with regards to your question and learning more about these models, probably the best place to start would be in reading the white paper. To further learn or contribute to this and our ongoing efforts, I would also encourage interested parties to sit in on a few meetings and consider joining the CDX working group.
Thanks again, Tony, for this highly informative discussion on chiplet ecosystems in this second episode of our 3D IC series. We're out of time for now, but we're looking forward to future podcasts with you on the evolution of the 3D IC workflows coming soon. Thanks again, and thank you all for listening and joining us today.